You've been accepted to a graduate program at a prestigious university, and you begin your classes and begin work, and all of a sudden that thesis that's the culmination of many master's programs becomes a reality. You always knew it was there, but all of a sudden you really have to buckle down and do what may be, for many people, the first really long paper the students have ever done. And it frightens us. It frightens me. And what you end up doing when you have to do a big research project is think of every reason you can to not do it. My checkbook. I haven't done anything to balance my checkbook in months. There's a stain on my carpet over here. That's got to be fixed. And once you recognize this human tendency to avoid doing the work, one attempt to make this go easier for you might be to establish a routine. There's a very famous historian and writer who I've long admired, and he's got a way to get many, many big, important books done. And what he does is get up every morning at the same time, dress as if he's going to a business office, leave his home at the same time every day, and walk as if he's going to go to work down the steps into a basement where he has his office. And there he sets up a routine. He works on his project all day. He has patterns and reinforcement that keep him making his goal of how much research and how much writing he must do at each chunk of time. And it works beautifully. At the end of the day, he finishes, goes home, and he has accomplished a chunk of work. And I think that's what we want to do. Establish a routine, do it regularly, do it all the time you can in a pattern that sets up for accomplishment, and this will get us over that carpet cleaning hump. The next problem comes, what are you going to do? Sometimes your advisors give you ideas. Sometimes they're good ideas, but sometimes they don't exactly work for you. I had one advisor give me an idea that I spent a great deal of time on and didn't work. He wanted me to translate a German writer's works from German, which I vaguely knew, but not very well, and produce a book or produce a thesis that was on this German writer's explorations of the United Kingdom. By the time I'd spent a month in the library trying to get through a few pages, I realized I really didn't want to do this. And it really was more my advisor's idea of what he wanted than what I wanted. At just about that time, I'd been walking the streets in Upper Manhattan, and I saw a big, solid-looking oak chair. And I kind of needed a chair. So I bought it for $15, brought it home, and as I was cleaning it, I noticed underneath it that there was a label that identified the maker of the chair. And I looked at the label and said to myself, I've never heard of this. And I studied Deco Arts a bit, so what's going on? And I went to the library and discovered that that chair was made by a man who was a great believer in high-minded, solid arts and crafts furniture, and that he started a business of handmade, high-quality work to live forever in people's houses out of good, fumed oak. Well, now that was a topic, because everybody had duly forgotten about this man. He was as obscure as they could be. And the more I started studying him, the more I discovered there was a story there. Not only did he want to rewrite the way Americans lived in a house and to establish solid values for solid families and to yearn for something that was practical yet beautiful. And then I discovered he had a couple of brothers. The original man had a colony of workers. It was happy workers. He sort of saw himself as back in the good old days of the Middle Ages. But his brothers had the same surname. And they saw the success the elder brother had. And so they started making copies of the same chairs by machine, so they were cheaper. And they went in at the middle class market in America. And before you could turn around, they'd driven his brother out of business. The whole thing was over by the 1920s, and everybody forgot about them. My point here is that sometimes you will find the topic you want to do by a serendipitous route, but it must be something you care about. You must be interested in the topic to keep yourself going over the humps when you want to think about the carpet cleaning again. So what you want to do is find a topic that resonates with you. Now, you want to work it out with your advisor. You don't want to do something your advisor knows is a bad idea. But if you can find a topic that really works for you, that'll get you through all those boring days in February and March when the world seems to be coming to a dark end anyway. And I suggest that you work on a topic you like. And you'll be surprised at what can happen. Somebody said to me fairly recently that they'd like to know more about a building we all knew in New York City. I knew the building, I'd never particularly studied it. But I looked into it, and you know what's funny? When you look into something, often, rather like an onion, you find layers of information that turn that task into a wonderful story you can use in your future. I discovered that this building, not only was it a big, important building that kind of links up the business community of early 20th century America with the government of the growing city, there were all sorts of analogies, and we learned that there'd been a lot of corruption in New York City buildings, so this was particularly brought in to be clean and to have to be done by people who've never had any scandal. What I think I'm trying to say is, underneath a big monument, you can often find a story. What you have to be careful to do is make sure that story hasn't been told by anybody else, of course. But if you look into a monument people know, and you find new information, that's a kind of good way to establish yourself in a career. Because when you go to an interview, and you can say, my thesis was on X, and I found out Y, if it's a topic people know, your interviewer will remember you, and you will propel yourself, hopefully, forward into a better position. Okay, so you've got yourself a topic and you set it up and you bring it to your advisor and you say, okay, I'm going to work on this. Here's what I'm going to do. Here's how I'm going to do it. And this is what I'm going to conclude. Warning number 3, don't stick to the conclusion and don't make the conclusion you propose guide your research. I've been working for a long period of time on the Gilded Age in New York City, on the speculatively built and then personally built row houses that lined Fifth Avenue and established the avenue as the place where wealthy people and where people put on a social pretentious layer in the late 19th century. And it sort of works to the present day. We still think of Fifth Avenue as an elegant street. And as I went into all of this work, my conclusion was that Fifth Avenue kind of stops about World War I because there's a built community above it to the north. It couldn't go more to the north anyway. And economically speaking, it was getting pretty expensive, even for very pretentious people. My conclusion, while partially right, was greatly wrong. So let the information lead you to the correct conclusion in the end. Don't bend the information. Have the information bend to you so that in the end, you'll present your material and you will have a conclusion based on all the work that you've done. So writing a thesis, really, in the end, can be a lot better and a lot more rewarding than we initially think when we start out on the process. The points we made were to find a routine that works for you, establish and do it regularly, treat it as if it's a serious portion of your job as a student, and to work on a subject that really works for you, to find a subject that you enjoy doing and that will give you the energy to do some extra work and to let the material take you on the road to the conclusion, even if you think it's going to go somewhere, and specify where that place will be. That place may change, but that's okay because your work will be the better for it. When you've got a great thesis done, you take it to your advisor, you take it to the committee, you take it and get the degree. But it goes farther. When you look for a job, your employer may very well ask you what you did your thesis on. And if it was on a monument that might be recognizable in your field, and if you've had a conclusion and you'd learned things that people didn't know, that makes you stand out at the job interview. And the interviewer, the person who's about to hire, will remember you, perhaps, and you'll get the job. So doing a great thesis on something that you do well, that you love, that gets a great conclusion on a monument people know, that may propel your career forward into a book, into an article, into a job. So make the most of the thesis. It's not so scary, and the results in the end may be just what you need for your future.